right there, my class. They're amazing. And with that, you should thank each other. Everybody turn to the person next to you and thank each other for being so great. Exactly, exactly. So, the reason you're so great is because you are so respectful, attentive while this is going on. So I would appreciate it if you had the phones out and put away so nobody sees them and you are giving your full attention up here. Thank you, you guys are great. So I'm gonna be done talking right now and I'm going to invite Trinity Martin up here first. So please give Trinity a round of applause.
Hi. So I wrote this memoir about a former crush, my phone number, and a paper frog. And then my English teacher pestered me to use it for Writer's Week. Shout out March, 7th period. The cool part about using real people in your writing is that you have to get their permission to do so. So when I was submitting this to read here, I had to ask my ex-crush for her permission, which means she had to read it, which means it currently, like, explicitly refers to her as my crush. So you know what I had to do to be reading this here, and I hope it was worth it. And without further ado, paper frogs jump, and frankly, it's out of my hands. The clock was ticking. I wouldn't be back until Monday, and it was now or never. My stomach was doing kickflips and landing none of them. The paper amphibians grew damp within my sweaty, clenching fist, clearly not adapted to this kind of wetland. The bell rang. I slammed the folded creatures onto her desk and booked it for the door. I see the flickering hallway lights of freedom when I'm yanked back by the scruff of my neck by my appointed wingman, the lovely and terrifyingly strong Zoe Leanne Fugino. Entirely too supportive of my endeavors and determined not to let me chicken out, which is all well and good, except we're already past that part of the plan and she's preventing me from hopping in the getaway car. Panic sets in. I'm pumping my legs and flailing my arms to escape. You know, very subtle that I don't have a crush or anything. Give her your number, Zoe booms, frightening in good faith. I did, I screech in desperation. Immediately, the resisting force on my shirt collar is released, and I'm flung forward into a row of lockers. No time to dwell on stretched shirt collars or bruised limbs. I borderline sprint down the hallway, grateful that I won't have to face my crush until Monday. The hard part is over, and now I wait for a text. 1 hour goes by. Then two. Did I write my number wrong? Nah, she just hasn't had time to text yet. Yeah, that's it. School ends. Did she see the unfold me note on the legs of the origami frog? Hour four, crickets. Five, I must have written my number wrong. It's the only possibility. 8 hours later and nothing. Radio silence. A text is not coming. After my lengthy 7 hour journey through the stages of crush grief, I'd accepted that for whatever reason, she didn't want to text me. On the bright side, however, I had put myself out there and was determined not to let it bother me, or worse, make my favorite class of the day awkward. All things considered, I was glad I did it and ready to pack it up, shove it in the high school learning experiences box, and demand my therapist give me a gold star for emotional maturity. Play the outro music, roll credits, we got our resolution, folks. The end. Not the end. You're telling me I did all that and she didn't even get my number. And out of all people, Zoe Leanne Fugino found it. Hundreds of students walk the hallways of Fremd High School. The only named character in the cosmic comedy that my life had become found the frog. And I bestowed this information while in a car, barreling me farther and farther and farther away from Fremd High School and away from being able to do anything about it for 3 days. Yay! So it seemed all was lost for my venture of love. I'd already spent the last 12 hours talking myself out of the crush, and now I was too dispirited to try and fail a second time. Even if I was impassioned to give it another shot, I would have to wait 3 whole days to make another move, and that's plenty of time to talk myself into being alone forever. But sitcom episodes need a good ending, and by God was the universe gonna give it to me. Re-enter one Zoe Leanne Fugino. Wingman till the end, she offers to give my crush the frog a second time. Perfect. Now I have 3 hours until she reaches sixth period, where I will surely not use this time to doubt, dread, and agonize over this decision. So naturally, I use the time to do exactly that. Honestly, I owe Zoe a lot for all the anxious and sappy messages I sent her during that 3 hour period. But while she indulged my gushing, she was not having any of my cowardice and replied to all my anxious pleas to abort the mission with, I'm handing her the frog from yesterday during class and ignoring anything else you tell me. The plot progresses whether I want it to or not, apparently. Before I knew it, thanks to a convenient time skip we in the biz like to call a nap, it was 12:05, the beginning of sixth period. The charade of reading my book and pretending I'm not checking my phone every couple seconds doesn't last very long when I finally receive a notification. A text. The text. The one I've been waiting for, agonizing over, for the last 24 hours. And I'm head over heels. The end. Next up is Avisha Uramilli.
Hello. I just wanted to thank you. I just wanted to shout out Mr. Dawson's seventh period class. Real quick before I start, I do want to say that I discussed domestic violence in this, so if you need to step out and take care of yourself, please do so. My journey with compassion. As my father and I walk through the double doors of Costco, various smells and sounds come over me in a familiar comfort. A weary, exhausted mother pulling her screaming child along, the industrial smell of the warehouse, old woman in hairnets calling out, "Try Tostino's pizza rolls," and the unmistakable feeling of simultaneous urgency and nonchalance in the air. Shopping with my father has always been a calm and quiet ritual. We slowly make our way through the store, picking up groceries, tasting samples, and wandering up random aisles as if we have all the time in the world. I treasure these moments with my father because it has not always been that way between us. My relationship with my father is best described as fragile. My dad has been abusive towards my mother in the past, and as a result, I've grown up distrusting him. The pain his actions have caused my family is something I struggle to forgive, and it's difficult trying to see my father as the loving man he can be compared to the cruel, cold person he has been. However, I'd be lying if I said I don't care for him. He is loving in the way he envelopes me in his big, hairy arms. He is caring in the way he pushes me to eat. He is supportive in the way he encourages me to pursue a life that brings me joy. I have learned that while my father can be cruel, he can also be kind. By no means am I excusing my father's behavior. It just took me a long time to realize that it is possible for a person who does hurtful things to also have nurturing qualities. Last winter break, I suffered from a lymph node infection. At first, I thought it was just an abscess that would eventually disappear, but within a few days, it had tripled in size, and it was becoming difficult to function due to the pain. My dad took me to the emergency room where I was told I need to get an ultrasound so the doctor could see what was happening. In the ultrasound room, I was told to lay on the table and lift my arm. At this point, the pain was so bad, it was a struggle just to lift my arm, but I complied. However, I don't think anything could have prepared me for the amount of pain I'd feel once the nurse started rubbing the ultrasound device into my arm. I shoved the nurse's arm away, turned to my side, and sobbed so hard and uncontrollably, I couldn't even make a noise. Within seconds, my father was at my side, hugging me as I cried. He told me that I was going to be okay, everything will be fine, and that he was here. My father was here. He held me through the rest of the ultrasound, and afterwards, as I weep from the throbbing pain, he continued to hold me in his embrace. Later, as I laid in my hospital bed, it occurred to me that I had never thought my dad was capable of showing me so much affection. In my mind, he had always been an evil monster. What kind of a monster shows his daughter so much kindness? It made me realize that despite all of the horrible things my father has done, it doesn't mean he's incapable of being loving and compassionate. That is why shopping with my dad at Costco is more than just running errands. It symbolizes his humanity. As strained as our relationship feels at times, our trips to Costco represent the good times with my dad. They help me see him in a different, more compassionate light. Again, I'm not excusing my father's actions. Domestic violence should never be condoned. And I sympathize with those of you who have experienced it as well. My experiences with my father have made me realize that at the end of the day, we are all human, capable of being both kind and cruel. It's the choices we make that differentiate us. Thank you. Okay, next up we have Samantha Chapin.
Hi, I'm Sam. First off, shout off to Miss Marsh's seventh period English class. So I'll be reading my memoir. A little backstory is my dad's side's Christian and my mom's side's Buddhist. So I wrote this memoir kind of just about what I think about a lot when I go back and forth between temple and church. And this all revolves around one day when I was a lot younger. It's called A 1 in 4,000 Chance of Being Right. The aroma of candles lingered through the room, and beautiful flowers were displayed around the floor, circling the bald men in traditional orange robes worn by the Thai monks. They led us in prayer, singing and chanting, while facing the giant statue of the Buddha, caressed in gold. The statue was sitting on a shelf, surrounded by extravagant flowers and fruit, 8 feet above where everyone else was sitting on the turquoise green carpeted floor. The school gathered all the students to the temple, and had us get into position to pray. I knew this would be a long day. I got onto my knees and laid my hands flat on the floor in front of me. Think of the stretch called the child's pose. That's the position they had us in for what felt like eternity. They went through the whole ritual. Meanwhile, my six-year-old self was getting restless. I don't agree with this. This is stupid, I thought. For as long as I can remember, I never agreed with the idea of religion, but I've never been opposed to it. And I actually find it fascinating how we use religion to answer the questions that don't make any sense to us. Questions like, where does space end? If space is always expanding, what does it expand into? We could say God created everything. Well, okay. I'm not saying that's wrong, but that's a pretty big claim with no backup evidence, besides the stories that came out of a book, the same stories that came out that only got written down 200 years after people had started telling them. It felt like a game of telephone to me. My dad's side is very Christian, and we went to church on Sundays. Even at 6 years old, the Bible stories never made any sense to me. I understand that the concept of religion can make people want to be the best versions of themselves, and I like that idea a lot. But I can't wrap my head around the fact that after I die, I go to heaven or hell based on my actions on earth, and there's just no end. Every story has an end, and the thought that there would be no end to my story scared me. When we die, we're supposed to live the rest of eternity in some place called heaven. Well, here I was, sitting in temple, not worshiping God, but worshiping the Buddha. What happens if my dad's side is correct and my mom's side is wrong? Do I never see my dad again? If I don't necessarily agree with any of this, then when I die, does everything become nothing? How do I define nothingness when I die? What does that even look like? Well, it looks like nothing. But what's the difference between nothing when I'm conscious and nothing when I'm unconscious? Soon prayer was over, and my classmates decided they want to play a tag at recess, play a game of tag at recess. The tagger was coming for me. I dodged him and looked back to give him the, "You're slow" smirk. I guess I was enjoying my spectacular dodge that I wasn't looking where I was going and collided with another kid who was also trying desperately not to get tagged. We both started crying because my head collided with his. My elbow was scratched up along with his knee being badly hurt. The monks came to his aid with a band-aid and ice, but could not help me. It was a rule that a monk was not allowed to make skin-to-skin contact with a female. They told me they would go grab a female teacher, and I sat there confused. "Why can't you help me?" I asked the monk. "It's a rule. It just wouldn't be appropriate," he said. When my female teacher came to my aid, I asked her why the monks couldn't help me. "There's a rule that forbids monks to touch women's bodies. It's to prevent distraction, as the monks are trying to achieve mindfulness and purified minds. So they want to avoid being distracted by lust. However, it's a choice a monk made for himself. Also, it doesn't mean he has lust for you, but if it applies to women his age, it applies to women of all ages. That's just the rules," my teacher said. There it was again, the rules. Yes, they are rules and everyone believes it, but just because one person said it and everyone believes it, does that make it morally correct? What makes a rule right or wrong? I had no idea where to go with this information, and honestly, I still don't know what to do, what to think. He isn't hurting anybody by doing this. He's not shaming women. He's doing this for himself, I guess. But then I asked the question, why is the woman's body the thing that's considered a distraction? A woman's body is only distracting because society has deemed it distracting, because we have censored it and made it something inappropriate. It's just like our money. A piece of paper has no value. Suddenly you say it's worth $10 and it has value. The piece of paper never changed, but people gave it value and now everyone wants it. Then when you want it, people will tell you it's a distraction and that money blinds you. So why do we deem a female's body distracting in the first place? I know men with way bigger tits than mine, and I don't hear anybody saying, "Wow, that dude is such a slut for wearing that tight shirt." There is no rule book of life we have to obey, so we get our morals from religion. But those ideas that became those morals had to originate from somewhere, right? I got home and thought about the day I had, and eventually came to the conclusion. Religion is something people grow up with. Who are we to tell them that it's right or wrong? We use creationism to explain the things we don't understand, the philosophical and societal questions that nobody has an answer to, but only in theories. And maybe we never will. Maybe one day I'll use a religion to answer my undying questions about the world around and outside of us. However, there are 4,000 religions in the world, and we have a 1 in 4,000 chance of being right. Nevertheless, if you die and found out you chose wrong, just know that you were basically dead billions of years before you made it to Earth and left. Do you ever remember suffering? I don't. But we're here now, and we may not be guaranteed an afterlife, but we are a 1 in 8 billion in a galaxy full of unlimited galaxies. So don't think about where you end up afterlife too much, because at the end of the day, we're just a blip in time. And time is infinite, but not for us. Thank you. Next up is Natalia Delgado.
Sorry. Hi, I'm Natalia Delgado, and also a shout out to Ms. Moreno's 7th grade class and the Last Girls group. So today I'll be reading a piece called Walks and Whistles. I wrote this, so this is a story about something that happened to me when I was 13 years old. I am 17 now. I didn't write it that long ago, but it's just something that happened when I was 13. I do touch on the subject of misogyny and verbal harassment in what I will be reading today. So if that is anything that bothers anyone, feel free to step up. I love Mexico City. Its colors change as you shift your eyes to the building that stands tall around you. The thousands of restaurants and food stands all over the streets. "Tamales oaxaqueños," says the one with the cart full of tamales as he makes his way around the town. "Tortas, pasen por sus tortas." The lady with the box hanging around her neck like a necklace yells as she walks under my window. "El pan, compre su pan de la mañana, señor." The old man in jeans and a flannel offers the lady with her kids in the corner by the convenience store. Señorita, venga, siéntase, comes un taco. They offer the girl as she walks towards her house. The people rush in and out of the market in a perfect formation, getting their groceries. I watch all of this from the second floor window of the house when my cousin calls me from the door outside. Natalia, vamos al parque. I start to think that I've never walked the streets of Mexico City alone without a man by my side while visiting here. I still agree to go. It's only a mile walk from my house to the park. We walk to the park, chatting along the way, since I haven't seen her in 2 years. She's definitely changed, grown up, matured, while I still look like the same kid that visited 2 years ago. We spend a little time at the park admiring the art on the walls from the people's graffiti over the years, watching the children run around and the vendors trying to make money off of the 100 children. As we walk back to the house, we pass by a mechanic shop. The 5 rusty cars on the lot that are falling apart catch my attention, and then the men drinking beer on one of the cars instead of working catches my attention. They whistle at us, catcalling us as we pass by them. I just know to keep my head up and keep walking. This until I hear my cousin curse at them as we walk past in front of them. I start walking faster, terrified that they heard her and could start following us. We keep walking, and that's when I realize that even though Mexico is beautiful, it's also dangerous, especially for me. I may look like everyone here, but I don't belong. They have skin that's grown thick to these events, while I'm from the US suburbs, where these type of things rarely happen. A simple whistle is nothing. This may be the first time, but not the last time it will happen. It could be worse, since we're living in a world where a 13-year-old girl getting whistled at by men in their late 20s while she walks the streets is normal, when it shouldn't be. Women should be able to walk the streets freely without fear of being sexually assaulted because what they're wearing is too revealing. We should be free to express ourselves in whatever way we want without any fear that something might happen to us. Thank you. And up next, reading her piece, is Remya Rajan.
Hi, everyone. I just want to shout out Mr. Herridge's 7th hour English class. So I'm just going to be reading you a short story about the time my grandpa took me to the gas station, based on a true story. Trick or treat, exclaimed my 2 cousins and I as we excitedly hit our last house for the day. It was the evening of Halloween, and we had just finished collecting candy from all the houses in the neighborhood. It was a cloudy day, a perfect complement to the spooky scenery of jack-o'-lanterns and spider webs in all the neighbors' front yards. 7-year-old me was so thrilled to go home and eat all the candy we'd collected with all our hard work. My cousins and I eagerly headed back to the house, trying to contain our excitement. We rang our doorbell and bolted inside after our parents opened the door, excited to show off our candy to all the adults who were waiting there. While my cousins and I were sorting through our candy to figure out which ones to trade, our grandpa walked into the room with his vampire costume. He told all the grandkids to get in the car because he wanted to take us all to get slushies. Of course, us being sugar-loving kids, we're ecstatic at the idea. Slushies? Who would say no to that? My cousins and I bursted out, jumping up and down with joy. Our parents, who now had to deal with even more sugar in their children's systems, were not thrilled. Nevertheless, they wanted to let us have fun on Halloween with our grandpa. Okay, kids, you can go, but make sure to stay close to grandpa and stay out of trouble, announced my mom. Okay, mama, I exclaimed, excited to get my blue raspberry slushie. We got into my grandpa's car, and he drove us to the gas station that we were going to get our slushies from. I cheerily ran inside to the gas station counter to buy our slushies. As I was waiting for my grandpa to come to the gas station counter to buy our slushies, I realized he wasn't even walking toward the counter. Instead, he was heading toward the slushie machines with my 2 cousins. I followed him there and asked, "Grandpa, let's go get our slushie cups. How are we gonna get slushies with no cups?" "But we already do have cups," he answered, and pulled 3 sippy cups from his bag. "Grandpa, we can't do that," I extorted. "Yes, we can," he replied. And with that, he turned to the slushie machine and hurriedly began filling up the sippy cups with slushies, 3 little kids yelling what flavors they wanted in their cups to him. All while the gas station worker was watching us behind the counter. He looked around 17 and kept on looking around like he didn't know what to do. I mean, what would you do if some random elderly man came to your gas station with three whiny kids and starting filling his own slushies? Sir, you're not allowed to do that, he told my grandpa. Why not? Asked my grandpa, unbothered, still filling our sippy cups with slushies. Because it's against the rules. I'm gonna have to call my manager, he claimed. Right as he went into the back to get his manager, my grandpa screwed the lid back on our sippy cup, looked at us, and said, run, they're gonna catch us. And we ran out the store with our slushy-filled sippy cups, giggling with excitement and satisfaction that we got our slushies. To be honest, though, I was kind of scared I was going to be put into jail for not paying for our slushies, but I got over that pretty fast since it was a blue raspberry slushie, my favorite. Blue raspberry slushies were worth going to jail for. By the way, if you prefer cherry slushies over blue raspberry ones, you're wrong. Anyway, we got into the car and quickly put on our seatbelts. My grandpa then started driving home, laughing all the way. We're too fast for them, he chuckled. This is a one-time thing, though, you understand. We can only do it this one time because that gas station owner wanted to act smart with me last week. Last time, he charged me for a large, and I only got a small. We're just making up the difference. Anyway, drink your slushies. And we did. We got home to our waiting parents and the heaps of Halloween candy yet to be eaten. My mom hugged all of us and said, did you guys stay safe and listen to Grandpa the whole time you were out? We simply smiled at each other and said, oh yeah, we listened to everything he told us to do. Thank you. And next up we have Alec Osado.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Alec Osado. Thank you all for being here. It's an honor and a pleasure for us to be able to present to you guys. In a few moments, I'll be showing my one-man short film production. But before we start, I'd like to give a shout out to Mr. Dawson's 7th period class. Thank you. The Crank Revolution Bike Shop, who I am a part of and work media with. We're a bike shop located in Hoffman Estates, and we do bike-related live streams and video releases every week, so please do check us out at Crank Revolution. And big thank you to all my friends who are here. Your support means the world to me, so from the bottom of my heart, thank you for being here. And now, without further ado, please sit back, relax, and enjoy my short film, Why Do We?
Sometimes life just beats out. Do everything right. Do people kindly, work hard, always look forward to the best life. We live on sometimes things just don't work out. In those moments, as you fall into that common hole of self-pity, it's often the things that you want that help you remember where you see it. For me, I find that insightful. And the truth is, I don't really know why I do what I do. But in all honesty, Why do we ever do what we do? Sometimes I cycle through the mechanical clunks and clicks that give rhythm and consistency in the heart. The sound of each tap and trip, and the song you bump your head. Sometimes it's for the scent of a fresh set of tires, with the pungent aroma of a new tooth, a reminder of exhilarating adventures to be taken. Sometimes it's just to admire these beautifully engineered pieces of art. Nothing more than you like looking at something built to be nothing other than bring the absolute best out of you. And sometimes it's born emotion. You know, there's something special about talking to a machine that you don't quite get with people. You don't use words or phrases or have to tiptoe that line between communicating and oversharing. It's a spiritual connection with something that should be capable of responding to human emotion. And yet it's so honest and personal that it makes you feel as if it's alive. At one point, that distinction between you and machine feels absolutely starts to work. Man and machine can sit together to form one group, and parts of you begin to move more apparently. And then the machine responds to that by taking on a lively, organic feeling. Every turn, every strength, every color spread, it feels as if it's alive and breathing underneath you, wherever you are. And once you cross a certain threshold, maybe 20, 25 miles an hour, everything goes fine. And then after this high-speed transfer, how do you feel is that the loop is speed and certainty? It takes a little bit of a moment, and it gently brings you back. All of those emotions, don't quite fit anything like that from me. That's why I do what I do. And why I love them.
Thank you.
Give another round of applause for these wonderful student performers. And since you've been such an amazing audience, we have a couple extras from Avisha and Ramya, and I think Avisha is gonna go first, right? All right, so welcome back, Avisha.
Who am I? I'm the smell of incense that my mother lit every day. I am loose, neon-colored, jump-to-run t-shirts. I'm the bejeweled, beautiful, scratchy clothing from India my mother shoved me into. I'm fingerprints colored with chalk and dust and Doritos in the summer. I am lips and tongue tainted blue from the freeze pops. I am little pink high-heeled shoes from my blonde, blue-eyed, hourglass-shaped Barbies. I am the scrapes and cuts on my knees and elbows after scampering up trees and tripping and falling a million times in an endless, breathless game of tag. I am humiliation and shame when some kid would poke at the Indian food my mother lovingly sent me. I am huge, gorgeous, warm pride, but only when I am alone with no one to compare myself to. I am tears in my bathroom asking why. I am insecurities, dark and ugly. I'm hours of pinching my body at night and wishing I look like the girls on Instagram. I am nights of terror and panic when the only thing I hear is my parents fighting. I am dark showers when I can't handle looking at myself. I'm rotten, stinky shame for loving myself and not boys, for loving girls. I am love, open, and welcoming for all, except some. I'm not a person with confidence, athleticism, or intelligence. I'm swirling paints of red, blue, orange, purple, and black. I'm hormonal, passionate emotions. I'm not a logical, straight, reasonable path. I am twists and turns and back to square ones. I am a continuous moving film, shaking, dancing. I'm proud of who I am. I've come a long way and I plan to continue going. Thank you.
Okay, so I'll just be reading a palindrome poem that I wrote. And palindrome poetry, if you're not familiar, is poetry that makes sense when it's read forward, but also when it's read backward. So I'll read it forward first, and then we'll go backward. Behind your mask. Who are you? I don't know how to feel, but the more I get to know you, I see why people like you. You're good at hiding who you truly are, so getting closer has revealed to me that you could truly make me smile. And I find it funny how hard it was for me to accept you because you are not who I thought you would be. And now we'll go backwards. Because you are not who I thought you would be, how hard it was for me to accept you. And I find it funny that you could truly make me smile. Getting closer has revealed to me you're good at hiding who you truly are, so I see why people like you. The more I get to know you, I don't know how to feel. Who are you? Thank you.
All right, everybody. We got a few minutes for some questions from the crowd for our panel. So if you have any questions for a particular performer or for the entire panel of performers, you can ask them now. Don't be shy. Right up there.
How hard was it to make the palindrome?
Honestly, it wasn't too hard. I had to like write and rewrite it like a few times, but just kind of try to make the lines like general so that they can flow like forward or backward. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's hard to do. That's hard to do. Right up here in the front. So the question is, what is the most difficult part of writing? I'm assuming for like the whole process, right? Great question. Thank you. You want to start here?
Personally, I write like way too much just to fill the space. So the hardest part is cutting it down and like knowing what isn't needed and then having too much anyways.
I'd say that the hardest part for me would be like, I'm a very passionate speaker. So like trying to not like come across too aggressive on a lot of my pieces. So I kind of just like sometimes have to dial it down a little bit to not be like doing it too much. So yeah, but then sometimes it turns out either too much or too little, so then I have to fix it.
I think the hardest part for me is honestly just starting. Like I think a lot of people don't really think of themselves as authors or people who can like write pieces, but I think you just need to like start writing. So that's the hardest part.
For me, I kind of tend to just vomit all of my thoughts into a page. And I guess for me, the hardest part is trying to make a cohesive piece out of everything that I've written down.
I would say for me, it's probably finding words that actually describe how I'm feeling. It's really hard for me to think of words that kind of correspond to what I'm trying to get across in my pieces.
That was exactly what I was going to say. Finding the right words for the right time is definitely the hardest part for me.
Russ, one more. We got one all the way up there. Go ahead. I'm guessing this is for Trinity. What happened with your crush after you texted them?
So it went great at first. There's a reason they're my ex-crush, though. It didn't go, like, super great, but it didn't go as bad as it could have. So I got to thank the universe for that.
Have to keep it ambiguous. That's good. Keep it ambiguous. Good? All right, everybody. I want to thank you for being a wonderful audience today. You guys are fantastic. Have a great rest of your day and the rest of the week. Great job. Might seem crazy what I'm saying. Some trash is here you can take away. How can you do that with those things? Yeah, like I don't care, baby, by the way. Because I'm happy all alone.
Thank you. up on that mic.